The events in Florida this week are heart-wrenching, and we continue to grieve with the family and friends of the victims and the entire Parkland community. These tragedies are always difficult to process, even by bystanders in other states. But as you know, late yesterday, we learned about a young man who was planning a school shooting right here in Vermont. This is a stark reminder that we are not immune to tragic violence. First, I want to thank the law enforcement agencies who identified this risk and acted quickly with school officials to protect students and apprehend the suspect before anyone else could be injured. But it's also important to note that if not for the individuals who spoke up and reported something abnormal and concerning, we might be having an entirely different conversation today. And we can't accept that. When I took office, I issued an executive order outlining three guiding principles of my administration, the third of which was to protect the most vulnerable. So I want to make this point very clear. We have a responsibility to make sure when we put our kids on the bus or drop them off at school, we're doing everything we can to keep them safe. I've said many times, public safety is the primary function of any government. It rises to the top and is our number one responsibility. If we are at a point when we put our kids on a bus and send them to school without being able to guarantee their safety, who are we? And I want to be honest. Just yesterday, I did an interview noting we were the safest state in the nation. And this is very true. I also said that we have adequate gun laws that balance our rights with public safety. But the reality of how close we came to a devastating tragedy underscores the threat of violence that faces the entire country. Thankfully, in this case, we were prepared. But the obvious questions are, what can we learn from these situations? Is there more that we can do? To start answering this question, my administration will work with legislative leaders, local government, law enforcement, and education stakeholders to ensure all our procedures and policies are as current and as effective as they can be. As my team will share, we have strong protocols in place, but I've also directed them to review our current efforts and work with schools to identify any additional needs. As well, I've asked Commissioner Anderson and Secretary Holcomb to make sure as much of this work is done, is completed while the students are away for February vacation. Now, you've covered me almost for a year now, and you know I'm generally steady, measured, and I realize that sometimes this is viewed as being unemotional. But to be quite honest with you, in the aftermath of Florida, this situation in Fairhaven has jolted me, especially after reading the affidavit and realizing that only by the grace of God and the courage of a young woman who spoke up did we avert a horrific outcome. As a result, I've been asking myself, are we doing everything we can to protect our kids? So while I fiercely and strongly support all constitutional rights, including the Second Amendment, the fact is these tragedies have become all too frequent. And though we have a strong program in place that led to a successful outcome in Fairhaven, we must determine if we are truly doing all we can to prevent violence. As governor, I have a responsibility to provide for the safety of our citizens, especially our kids, which means having an honest and open and fact-based discussion about access to guns by those who shouldn't have them. So I'm committed to working with the legislative leaders to identify policy changes that may better ensure the safety of our children and all Vermonters. That includes better identifying and treating mental health needs and other root causes of violence, determining why so many children slip through the cracks, and having an open conversation about gun safety. I often say that the solutions we are elected to find are always achievable, but only if we don't allow our work to become clouded by politics or retreat to ideological corners. While gun safety can be part of the conversation, it can't be just about guns. The root causes of violence that must also be addressed as well. I'm hopeful every Vermonter, from the most anti-gun advocates to the strongest Second Amendment supporters, will join in the responsible discussion we must have about ways to reduce violence in our society and keep our children safe in our schools. Our goal must be to find real solutions, steps that will make our schools and communities safer, not just things that make us feel better because we've done something. I know these conversations will be passionate and solutions are not going to be easy, but they are important to our children, our communities, and to ensuring we remain the safest state in our country. In closing, I want to thank our law enforcement and school communities for their response to Fairhaven and my team here in this room. And as the community of Fairhaven reflects on this news, I want them to know we all stand with them. I'd like to turn over now to Commissioner Anderson for a briefing on our school security measures and the case in Fairhaven.
Good afternoon, everyone. Tom Anderson, Commissioner of Public Safety. This has been a very sad, disturbing, and tragic week for the United States and Vermont. In Florida, 17 families have been forever changed, a school has been forever changed, and a community has been forever changed. In Vermont, the Fairhaven Police and the Vermont State Police yesterday arrested an 18-year-old who was aiming to cause the same type of horror and mayhem in Fairhaven. We like to think that because we live in one of the safest places in the country, we are immune from such horror and tragedy. Unfortunately, just like Parkland, Florida, thought it was immune, we aren't either. The difference is that I can stand here today and tell you that because someone heard something disturbing, and said something, that Vermont school officials and law enforcement were able to thwart the kind of tragedy now gripping Parkland, Florida. Governor Scott has made his commitment to school safety crystal clear to both public safety and to the Agency of Education. These incidents have only caused him to rededicate the state's efforts to make our schools as safe for our kids and educators as is humanly possible. The purpose of this press briefing is threefold. One, to reassure Vermonters that we have a very robust and effective school safety program. Two, to discuss some of the additional steps we are taking in light of these events, which includes the Vermont State Police Barracks Commanders reaching out to schools in their areas of responsibilities. And to provide a briefing on the arrests made yesterday in connection with the events in Fairhaven. Before we get to that, I would like to introduce Secretary Holcomb, who's been a tremendous partner in assuring our school safety.
Thank you, Commissioner Anderson. First of all, I need to start by thanking educators in Parkland, but also in here in Vermont. When people go into teaching, it's because they believe in the promise of our young people. And the first thing you realize when you enter the classroom is that parents are sending the thing they care about most into the in the world into your care. And that's really our first trust, and the governor had it right. Our first public responsibility is for the safety of the children in our care. I'd also like to start by thanking our first responders locally and our school leadership teams across the state of Vermont, their staff, and all the community members across the state who work hard each and every day to keep our schools safe. Some of you know that we've begun every year, the last 2 years, by encouraging all our local responders to reach out to the schools and vice versa so that these relationships are rekindled at the beginning of the year. We feel very lucky to live in a state where we know our school safety partners by first name, and we appreciate the long-standing relationships that we've had with them throughout the state. As Commissioner Anderson said earlier, we keep our community safe through these relationships and by providing an open and welcoming community in all of our schools. I think it's prudent at this point to remind our school administrators to keep looking for new ways and creative ways to make sure that every single student, teacher, school administrator, or community member has an avenue to share any information that might come to them about behaviors of concern, whether it's bullying, hazing, harassment, or specific threats that may have a negative impact on our schools. These concerning behaviors may be experienced in person, and regrettably, they're increasingly experienced through social media. And it's important to recognize and report these behaviors to a trusted member of your local community. We've reached out today to ask our community members to be attentive to this and to make sure that our students know where to go if they have a concern. When incidents like this occur, we are always in communication with our principals and our superintendents. We reach up immediately to offer resources that they may find helpful in responding to or recovering from a critical incident at their school. Because obviously for places like Fairhaven, this is a conversation they're going to continue to be having. I very much appreciate the working relationships we've enjoyed with the Department of Public Safety, Vermont Emergency Management, and other state and local partners in our collective efforts to enhance emergency preparedness in our schools across the state. And with that, I'm very, very proud to introduce our school safety team, who will talk to you more about the details of this work locally.
Thank you, Secretary. Again, my name is Rob Evans. I'm the Vermont School Safety Liaison Officer, and I'm here with Ms. Emily Harris, who's a member of the Vermont Emergency Management Team. Earlier this week, we witnessed the devastating effects of yet another school shooting and the arrest in response to a school threat in Fairhaven. These horrific events remind us that every student, teacher, parent, school administrator, and community member plays a role in providing a safe and secure environment for all those who attend, visit, and work at our schools. Since 1999, the Vermont School Crisis Planning Team, made up of state preparedness partners, have been working to provide policy and best practice operational guidance to schools across the state. In 2016, recognizing the need for a more comprehensive school crisis planning initiative, the Agency of Education and Department of Public Safety collaborated to formalize the work of the School Crisis Planning Team and established the Vermont School Safety Center. The School Safety Center has a tremendous amount of contemporary standard and school safety resources to support schools, and many of these resources are available through the Vermont School Safety Center's website. Over the past 2 years, the Vermont School Safety Center and the Vermont School Crisis Planning Team have provided incident command, behavioral threat assessment, crisis communication, emergency operations planning, active shooter training, bomb threat response, and other trainings to schools across the state. And working with state and local partners, we've provided on-site school safety assessments and school crisis planning support, and hosted multiple school safety conferences to highlight the new and emerging trends in school safety. I'd also like to highlight that in December of 2017, 285 school safety partners participated in the Governor's School Safety Conference. This was the largest school safety conference we have had in the last 4 years. A large portion of this conference was dedicated to establishing and maintaining individual and organizational resiliency after a critical incident. We also understand that these types of tragedies may often trigger a wide range of stress or traumatic responses. We have shared information with principals and superintendents and offered trauma-informed best practices about talking to children about shootings that schools should utilize when discussing these situations with their school communities. However, one of the best things we can do to keep our schools safe is to develop relationships between schools and the first response community before an incident takes place. To emphasize the importance of these partnerships, during the month of March, we will collaborate with local, county, and state law enforcement agencies to connect these agencies with schools in their areas to offer their participation and guidance in their already scheduled school safety drills. These partnerships ensure that key relationships have been developed, actionable plans are in place, and the strengths are used to fulfill their fullest potential. We understand that discussions of threats assessments, active shooter, and scenarios that require lockdowns, lockouts, and evacuations can be uncomfortable, but these very conversations can help minimize the impact of future incidents, and they keep us all safe. It's equally important to remind everyone to remain vigilant and to partner in a community caretaking approach and see something if you say something. No piece of information is too small. If you feel it could potentially keep a violent act from taking place, We must share these concerns with school safety partners in our efforts to keep these tragedies from happening in the future. I'll now be followed by Major Glenn Hall.
Good afternoon. Glenn Hall, I'm the Major of the Criminal Division for the Vermont State Police. Let me start off by just saying that this investigation is very active, ongoing. We have detectives still conducting interviews and collecting evidence in this case. So I'm going to walk through some of the details that were outlined in an affidavit prepared by a detective with the state police that was presented to the state's attorney's office and presented at arraignment today. I can tell you that the accused in this case, Jack Sawyer, was arraigned this afternoon in Rutland County on multiple charges and was held without bail. So to walk you through some of the details leading up to where we are today, on Wednesday, the 14th of February, the Fairhaven Police Department received a report of someone who may have been making threats to do harm at the Fairhaven High School. They immediately spoke with a woman whose daughter was an associate of Mr. Sawyer, as well as another male around the same age. And the mom conveyed to the Fairhaven police that she was concerned because Mr. Sawyer had previously made threats to the Fairhaven school some time ago, and that he had reportedly recently purchased a firearm in recent days. The Fairhaven Police Department began an investigation into this matter. A few things they learned was that Mr. Sawyer had actually purchased a firearm, a shotgun, from Dick's Sporting Goods in Rutland. They confirmed that. They confirmed that he had been kicked out of the high school in the past, and that he had left a treatment facility in the state of Maine in recent days, where he had been for the last over a year. And he had returned to Vermont. They spoke with Mr. Sawyer's father, who confirmed that Jack Sawyer had been in a residential treatment facility in Maine to cope with anxiety and depression, and that he had left the facility recently, returned to Vermont to look for a job. His father also told police that he had stopped taking medication that was prescribed to him for depression and ADHD. The Fairhaven police located Jack Sawyer on Wednesday the 14th to talk to him. And he had told police that he had previously been target shooting that day. So acknowledged that he had purchased this gun and that he was target shooting. There was no evidence at that time that he was planning to do any harm. He wasn't making any statements at that time. So the police at that time had no evidence and no reason to take him into custody to detain him at that time. On the 15th of February, so yesterday, Fairhaven Police reached out to the Vermont State Police for assistance. We received a call from the Dutchess County Sheriff's Department in New York, who had been contacted by a female student who reported receiving messages over Facebook from an individual who is plotting to shoot up Fairhaven High School. We were able to identify that person that was communicating with her as Jack Sawyer. Vermont State Police detectives became heavily involved in this case yesterday. So they were able to contact Jack Sawyer again, and he was brought to the State Police Barracks in Rutland where he was interviewed by detectives. So I can tell you that some of the things that resulted from that interview was Jack told us that he previously attended Fairhaven High School, that in December of his sophomore year, which would have been 2016, he ran away, drove to California. When he returned, his parents sent him to a treatment facility in Maine to be treated for anxiety and depression. He was in Maine until a few days ago. He told detectives that he was planning from a couple of years ago to shoot up Fairhaven High School. He told detectives he did buy a shotgun the previous day. He told detectives that he had been reading books on the Columbine shooting. He told detectives that he was angry not at the school itself, but at the institution. He admitted that he was planning to come back to Vermont to fulfill this plan to shoot up the high school, and admitted that this plan was, he had thought about this plan as recently as a week ago. He detailed specific plans as to how he was going to carry out this shooting, two detectives. He mentioned also buying an AR-15 and a 9mm handgun prior to doing this. He said he would have carried out the shooting, but wasn't sure when. And even with law enforcement intervention, he would carry it out when he had the opportunity. We conducted a search of his vehicle, and detectives recovered a 12-gauge shotgun, the same shotgun that we believe was purchased from Dick's Sporting Goods, 12-gauge ammunition that was also purchased on a separate transaction the same day from Dick's Sporting Goods. We recovered a journal that Jack Sawyer admitted was his. That journal was titled The Journal of an Active Shooter. We recovered books on Columbine, a digital camera, a gas mask, a video recorder, and thumb drives. These are, again, this is an ongoing investigation, so I'm giving you details that were outlined in the affidavit, which was made public today. So there are other things involved in this investigation right now. Search warrants. We are working closely with federal partners, FBI, ATF. We've been in contact with the U.S. Attorney's Office and working very closely with the Rutland County State's Attorney's Office. So the investigation will remain ongoing. We have a lot of work to do, but these are essentially the details that led us to charging Mr. Sawyer with the crimes that he's been charged with so far.
Well, we'll take any questions at this time.
None of this was precipitated by what happened in Florida?
I'll let somebody else answer that. From my perspective, no. It appears that it was has been being planned for quite some time. So nothing was as a result of Florida.
That's correct. So certainly we're looking into every aspect of what led us to this, but every indication is that this is something he's been planning for some time now.
Did you recover the AR-15 and the 9mm handgun?
No.
Are you looking for them?
We have no indication that he had purchased those yet.
You may have said this, but under what condition is he being held and what has he been charged with?
He's being held without bail. The charges on the affidavit are attempted aggravated murder, attempted first-degree murder, and attempted aggravated assault with a deadly weapon.
Well, again, I think everything should be on the table at this point. This situation led me to believe that we are not immune to what's happening throughout the country.
You use the term gun safety. You believe in gun control?
Well, I think gun safety is the accurate word at this point, and I believe that whatever we can do to protect our citizens, protect our kids in particular, is something that we must address, and we should take a look at everything. Senator Sears has one bill in particular that I believe has some merit, and again, without getting into the details, but I think it's a starting point for us to at least have a conversation.
I mean, is that something that changed? You mentioned, was it just yesterday, wasn't it? You were saying you had a different
I mean,
so
again,
changed since yesterday.
Well, again, I think with all the events from Florida being so far away and feeling as though we were immune to this type of threat, but reading the affidavit and seeing how close we came to disaster led me to believe that we should, I have an obligation to protect our citizens. I take that very seriously as governor. And it's something that I believe that we need to at least have the conversation.
So that's a change. I mean, I'm sorry to harp on it, but it's
well,
important.
No, that's right. I mean, I said yesterday, as early as yesterday, I had said that we didn't need to change any gun laws at this point in time. I still I want to make sure that we focus on the root causes of this. It's violence. It's not always just the gun. I mean, if you read the affidavit, which is interesting, he was planning this with a bomb first, but couldn't practice with it. So he went to a gun. So as we've seen throughout the world, if someone wants to commit violence of any sort, they will find the means to do so. And so it can't be, this conversation can't be just about guns. But having said that, I need to be open-minded, objective, and at least consider anything that will protect our kids.
It can't be just about guns, but guns have to be part of the conversation.
Well, again, that's why I said that from the beginning, that we have an obligation, I have an obligation to at least listen
and be open-minded.
Again, everything should be on the table to at least take a look. I'm convinced that many of these threats come from mental health issues as being the root causes. And I believe, again, that we are going to have to focus in that area. But at the same time, I have to be, if I'm asking others to be objective, I have to be as well.
There was something in one of the national media that referred to, maybe this is going to be President Trump's Nixon to China moment. I mean, as a Republican, could this be your equivalent of a Nixon to China and a Republican supporting gun control in a very gun-friendly state?
Well, I was struck by some of the comments that Governor Scott from Florida had made yesterday. And certainly this is very raw and real to him and them. And he said everything needs to be on the table at this point. So. He's a Republican. He's said that, and again, I think I have an obligation, considering how close we came to maybe facing the same situation right here in our very own state. I have an obligation to at least consider that.
This is a question maybe more for Major Hall, but is there anything to indicate that this individual should not have been able to purchase a gun? Do you have anything in his record that would have come up in that country?
I don't think we're there yet. Certainly, we're looking into every aspect of his life. We're certainly interested in talking to anyone who's had contact with him recently or in the last couple of years. But certainly, you know, that's a possibility. He was in a residential treatment program, but we don't have a lot of details.
Do you know, did he complete that residential treatment or did he leave before he was scheduled to go?
I don't know that.
For those of us who couldn't go to Rutland and get the paper from the court, is there any way you could distribute the affidavit somehow? It's now a public document.
I do not have the original affidavit that was filed with the court yet.
We'll still figure it out.
Okay.
Yesterday you gave an interview, and this was before Fairhaven, and you talked mainly about crisis training in schools, and I think you meant well, but those words had to sound awfully harsh to a lot of parents and children to say that the answer to this is to teach kids to duck and cover.
Yeah, I don't think that that's what, you know, if the full interview was laid out, I think there was a couple of pieces missing. I do believe that there are other aspects. We have to look at this in a holistic way. I did say that I didn't believe we needed any changes in our gun laws. I made that clear. But that was just one aspect in terms of what we're doing in our schools. And I think that we have an obligation to continue to do that, to reduce the threat, to be prepared. And I just wanted to make the point yesterday that we're doing some of that. We want to reassure parents. We want to reassure kids. We don't want kids to be afraid to go to school. We don't want parents to be afraid to put them on the bus. We want to make sure we're doing everything we can to keep them safe.
It's pretty common for Republican politicians and other pro-gun rights politicians to put this in terms of mental health, which, yes, it's part of the problem, but quite often shooters have no previous history that would trigger any sort of intervention. What do you do about that? And do you have any plans to beef up mental health services in any way that might be relevant to this problem?
Well, again, I think some of what we are proposing in our budget, embedding more mental health advocates into the communities, I think that that would be helpful. But I can't underscore enough how important it is for people to, if they see something, report it. That was key to this, averting this disaster, this crisis, was someone stepping up and doing the right thing to let us know. And we need to continue to do that. And I know that's difficult sometimes, but we have an obligation, each and every one of us, to try to prevent that. So we, again, Rob, maybe you want to say more on that.
So just to dovetail on what the governor was speaking about is trying to evaluate risk-based behaviors that may have a negative impact on our schools. For 2 years, the last 2 years, we brought in national thought leaders to talk about and educate and inform educators and first responders about the behavioral threat assessment process, to do what was just done down in Fairhaven, to identify these behaviors, get wraparound services provided to evaluate whether we're going down the path of a threat or we're going down a path that somebody just needs some help. And we have developed comprehensive practices for that. They're in our crisis planning documents. And as I said, we spent 2 years at our previous governor's safety conferences letting folks know how important it is. And if we're going to spend dollars, we should be spending just as many dollars trying to prevent these things as we are in responding and recovering from these types of things.